So it's a pleasure to be here. Sorry for, I guess, given that this was supposed to be a long set of tutorials, I'm kind of old school, so I like actually to use the whiteboard more, even though later we will switch to PowerPoint once we have enough kind of background. So we'll do our best. I just wanted to ask you where maybe they might even bring the third whiteboard if, I use a lot of them. So just logistic questions, should I try to put them over here in the center and have people back, or should I like keep them here or even back? I don't know, just the organizers. So it's okay like this. If there is a third one, I guess we'll put it in the center. So the reason I need at least two, that there will be like one table that we will continuously be filling throughout this tutorial. So in any event, so for now, is it okay? All right, if we'll readjust in the break if if needed. All right, so as I said, it's a pleasure to be here. So I'm going to start today with kind of introducing some basic concepts about randomness. Some of the study, actually most of the study, will be very theoretical. Having said that, there is like a subject which is very dear to my heart, but I'm not going to talk about, but the organizers just reminded me about it. So a lot of this stuff, it seems like theoretical and maybe like, beautiful and so on, but maybe not applicable to practice. But a lot of this stuff, for example, we have a series of works on building good random number generators, like attacking Linux random number generator, proving security of Windows random number generator, improving optimizations. So a lot of the stuff that is going to be covered here was like directly useful there. And I would dare to say this was like a highly applied set of work. So I believe a lot of concepts that you will learn here, not just from me, but from the other speakers, would be hopefully useful. All right, so let's get started. So I'm going to keep one table here. For now, I will ambitiously use a whole board. If we need more board space, we'll see maybe in the break, I'll make a slide and put it on this huge thing with this table. All right, so this is going to be the table that we are going to fill. And essentially, rather than splitting this tutorial or guess a school into like just basics definitions, where I will remind you what entropy is and so on, I just think we'll kind of keep our eye on this kind of big picture. And as we need to introduce something, we will introduce something. All right, so this is a table. So we'll have a bunch of rows and columns. So in the rows will be various cryptographic applications. So the applications that we will consider are not necessarily even cryptographic. So the first kind of task that we are concerned about in cryptography is just that people cannot lie. Oh. All right, let's try. I'll do my best. Oh, maybe. All right, yeah, you're right. This might be like important to write in maybe black. So the first row, I'll try to use bigger letters, but you have to deal with my handwriting. So this is what I call soundness, which is roughly speaking inability of potentially untrusted people to prove false statements, right? So it's just, so there is a statement, it could be either true or false, and we would like to to make sure that we can catch some people if they want to prove some false statements. The second and third row will be more traditional cryptographic things. So here I'll use OAuth to stand for authentication. So this is essentially usually, for this tutorial, I'll just think about message authentication. I want to sign a message. I want to say that this message comes from me. So this is a task of authentication. The third task, which is essentially, roughly speaking, half and half of cryptography, is more generally, I'll call it privacy. And the last task will come a little bit later. For now, I'm not going to fill it in, okay? So this tasks, and this is setting. So the first settings that we are going to consider, just to get everybody on the same board, is the setting of ideal randomness. So in this setting, we would like to see, So randomness in general, I will try to denote by the dollar sign. So this is a setting when we have like random numbers, right? So essentially the point of this school, how important are random numbers for various tasks, ability to generate random numbers, ability to have good randomness. So let's just go through this over here. So in this case, so here for now, by soundness, as I said, I will like talk about like questions which have a correct answer. Does this graph has a Hamiltonian cycle? Or, you know, is Fermat last theorem true or false or something like that? So we'll have like about, in complexity theory, usually we abstract it as a class of like languages which can be decided in polynomial time and so on, or classes P versus NP. So I assume you are a little bit familiar with that, even though it's not needed for the rest, it's just for the big picture. So this table is going to tell you kind of a big picture of what we are going to study. So in this setting, if you have essentially randomness, you can actually do amazing things. So there is a famous, so the class in question is called the class of interactive protocols. So here we allow, you know, essentially somebody whom we call a prover to interact with some kind of verifier. The verifier is computationally bounded, the prover is potentially computationally unbounded, but the prover isn't trusted. So the class of kind of statements that we can prove is called the class of interactive protocols, a pretty big class called IP, and there is a celebrated result proved in the early 90s that this is actually a really huge class. So this kind of, so this is equal to class of languages which can be proven, you know, which when you compute it using polynomial space, so it's a huge class. And essentially it just shows you that randomness is important, and indeed, randomness is really crucial, as we will see in this kind of setting. So it's a really big class that we can do. So essentially for soundness, randomness really helps us a lot. And of course, moving to cryptography, we'll kind of come back to this a little bit shortly. But coming back to cryptography, of course, for authentication and privacy, so while here randomness, well, we will see how important it is, but for authentication and privacy, it's really critical because if you want to do cryptography, we need to have an ability to have secrets. And the only way currently we know how to model secrets is using randomness. So secret is something that the attacker doesn't know about. What does it mean the attacker doesn't know about it? It means the attacker has uncertainty about the secret. So technically from the perspective of the attacker, the secret at least somewhat looks random, right? So if there is no randomness, somehow there is nothing to hide. So in this case, you know, and of course there is a very rich theory about it, which I'll, you know, compress to a check mark. So we have a lot of like theory of like mesh authentication, code signature scheme, beautiful. Lot of result was done, and essentially by now, you know, we pretty much overwhelmingly believe that using good enough kind of randomness, we should be able to do those things and do them pretty spectacularly. And more importantly, the same holds for privacy. So privacy are these kind of applications like encryption, zero knowledge, commitment schemes, anything, or you know, more even powerful ones like multi-party computation, where the point is to hide something from the attacker. So here, potentially, we're not trying to hide. We're trying to assert who we are and just want to make sure that people don't tell lies on our behalf. And here, we're trying to hide stuff, right? So essentially, the point is, you know, for cryptography, randomness is completely essential just to even define things. And even for soundness, as you will see as we move to the next column, it's very important. Which brings me to the second column before we said, so this is a column of the world with no randomness. So let's just see how this world looks like. So first, I just want to kind of start with the easy part. Essentially cryptography is gone. As I said, we need kind of randomness to model the ability to have secrets and so on. So at least the way we know, there will be no kind of cryptography. And even in complexity theory, there are pretty kind of dramatic implications. For example, in the world of no randomness, more or less we kind of collapse. It's a pretty large class, but still we collapse. Even if the prover can have interaction, it doesn't really help. We collapse to the class of languages in non-deterministic polynomial time. So it's kind of a big drop-off. Let me see what else I want to say about this setting. Okay, so so we can kind of see at least you know, there is a big gain in having randomness. So the question is, well, I've essentially done what am I going to talk for the remaining 4+ hours. So the setting we're going to talk about is essentially this realistic concern that, so here we assume like no randomness, here we assume ideal randomness, and ideal randomness is a very strong assumption. It means you have like a sequence of completely independent unbiased random bits, which are kind of unpredictable. There is like no correlation between these bits. So it's a very strong assumption, and you know, we need to get those bits somewhere, and it's unclear where we are getting those bits. So we would like to weaken this assumption. And essentially what I'm going to try to do for the rest of today is try to think what are kind of some realistic, hopefully minimal assumptions about randomness, which will allow us to do some of those amazing applications. So the third column we are going to call weak randomness. So this is like something kind of realistic. Let's see how much space I need, but we'll see if I need more space, we'll move it here. So anyway, so this is a setting of weak randomness, and so this is what I'm going to start explaining here. So what does it weak means? So, so intuitively we will assume that the random source is not necessarily the sequence of unbiased uniform random bits, but it comes from a source. Usually we call it an imperfect source. And you know, in some situations, the source is just assumed to be like a particular distribution, which is maybe not necessarily uniform. But that might be a little bit kind of too specific for us, because usually we don't really know exactly if, for example, I want to derive secret keys from my fingerprint. It's not like I know exactly the distribution of my fingerprint. I might need some make some assumption about it, but I might not know it exactly. So instead, what we will try to do, we will abstract it, and we will say that that our randomness comes with a source S. I don't know how to write it, or L, I don't know, whatever this letter is. Oh, wow, that's actually pretty cool. Something is happening upstairs. I didn't realize it. All right. Now I'll try to write better so that I'm not embarrassed later. Okay, so so what is a source L? And this is simply a family of, you know, whatever realistic, you know, the quote thing is not essential to define it. So it's essentially a family of distributions. And if you make this family like very wide, or essentially allow like arbitrary distribution, it means that we are in for very good, and we can actually tolerate this family. It means that we have like a good positive result, that we assume very little about the source. It contains lots and lots of distributions, and somehow application works for all of these distributions, so that's great. And if you make the source like very restricted, for example, if the source simply contains only one distribution, uniform distribution, well, that's what we assume kind of in this column. We can get great results, but this is kind of not really robust to kind of imperfections that happens in reality. So let me give you some kind of examples of sources which are realistic, and I guess we'll call distributions X here. Distributions. So I'll give you just a couple of examples. I don't want to spend too much time about it, because as we'll see, a lot of the results that I'm going to present are kind of general. We set on some general framework, and then when we need to do something like very particular, we will only then we will need to worry about the details of the source. So the first source that I want to talk about is what we call K-weak source. So here, just to make it concrete, we assume that, just for simplicity, just abstract it. So we'll assume that our strings will be like n-bit long. So just to set some letters, I mean, it could be variable lengths, but just to get started, I'll assume this. So the first sort, which is actually a very prominent source, and pretty much the ultimate source, as we will see shortly, is what we call a K-weak source. And it consists of all x such that for any little x in the domain, so I usually will denote by capital letters distributions and by lowercase letters particular values, we have, maybe I'll stick it here, probability of x is at most 2 to the minus a, 2 to the minus k. And so one notation, I will not use it that much, but I will just kind of define it. So we defined predictability of x to be maximum over all little x of probability x equals x. And also, the first important definition, the mean entropy of a distribution x is log 1 over predictability of x. Okay, so essentially this definition translated here, it's equivalent to say that h infinity of x is at least k. So what am I saying here in case you haven't seen it? Oh, thank you. So you can move it. All right, you can keep it. All right, so maybe in the break, if needed, I'll move the table. Thank you so much. Yeah, that should be enough, I hope. All right, so what does it say in case you haven't seen it? So actually, let me see who, just so that I know if I should kind of keep the current pace or go a little bit faster. So how many of you kind of have seen and worked with some kind of some notion of entropy and are relatively familiar with this? Okay, so majority, and who kind of haven't seen maybe that much, and it's okay to, I'll will not remember. All right, so there are a couple of people, so it's okay. So we'll go too fast, but we'll see. So anyway, so this is actually a very important notion of entropy for cryptography. So I will not define Shannon entropy, even though some, I might define it later. All right, I'll define it here. So there is a notion of Shannon entropy, which I will not use at all in this part for reasons that I'll explain. So this notion, essentially, it's sum over all x, probability x equals x, log of 1 divided by probability x equal x. I think I didn't mess it up. So this is kind of an important definition, the definition of Shannon entropy, and I want to contrast it with the definition of mean entropy. And this definition, roughly speaking, for those who have taken information theory class, it kind of tells you how many kind of random bits on average would a particular distribution have. But in some sense, it's not. This is primarily useful when you have a lot of independent copies of this kind of random variable. So in the limit, you can achieve things like Shannon capacity and so on. But if you have only one particular distribution, this notion is not super robust because, for example, I could have a distribution where some element happens with probability 99%, and the remaining 1% is spread over like a really huge kind of high support distribution. And if you plug in this formula, you will see that the entropy of the distribution is still pretty high. It will be like, let's say, maybe n divided by 100, so it will be like linear in n. But in cryptography or for like applications that I'm going to talk about, if this is a source that is probability 99%, it's constant, essentially, the attacker knows everything there is to know with probability 99%. So yes, with probability 1%, you can do amazing things, but you know, not many of us want to bet our life on this 1% event. So for things like in the limit and so on, this is a really amazing notion. But for cryptographic applications, you want to make sure that no outcome happens with significant probability, because if some outcome actually happens, let's say with probability 99%, or let's say with probability 1/8, then I can break the system with probability, break the scheme with probability 1/8. So it means, you know, probability 1/8 corresponds to like mean entropy 3. And indeed, you know, if the entropy is 3, our intuition says you shouldn't be able to do good things. So, and indeed, this is the right kind of notion of entropy, at least not the right, but arguably the most natural notion of entropy for cryptography. At the very least, the attacker shouldn't be able to guess our secret is probability. If you want 2 to the minus k security, at the very least, this should hold, and that's why this notion of mean entropy is so kind of useful. And now, turning back to our big picture, so what does it tell us about our big picture? So if we can design an application or a cryptographic scheme or like a kind of a protocol for proving some membership in some language or an encryption scheme, which tolerates a weak source or k weak source, and ideally it would do it for a pretty low value of k, that's a pretty remarkable result. It says under the minimal assumptions that we can hope to achieve any security at all, right? Because if you don't have mean entropy, there is nothing, you know, the attacker knows everything, or, you know, he can like guess something with high probability. So this is really the least we need to assume about all distributions in our source, that they have some kind of mean entropy. And we can have a scheme that surprisingly works. So when I design the scheme, I don't know exactly which distribution it is, but the only thing I assume about it is that it has mean entropy, then we're in really good shape. So this would be like, so, you know, ideal kind of goal. So dream would be, you know, build application secure for k weak source. For k much, much less than n. Because that source arguably, yes, of course, some people believe there is no randomness at all, but you know, for those people who say, okay, there is no cryptography at all. But if you want to make some assumption that there is some uncertainty in the world, if we can make security for a k-weak source for value k much, much less than n, we'll be in very good shape. So this is what we'd like to do. And we will see in some cases the answer is yes, and in some cases the answer is no. And in cases where the answer is no, we can, of course, try to have other examples. And I'm going to give you just a couple because this is not that important, even though in the early days there was a lot of research trying to kind of define various imperfect sources and doing cryptography with it. So essentially the game is, yeah, if this is kind of too general that, you know, you cannot have a scheme that simultaneously works for all this min-entropy k distributions, maybe you can know a little bit about your source and you can have a scheme that works under hopefully reasonable assumptions. And the problem with this result, I'll mention these two, you know, couple of sources in a second. The problem with this result is, well, this is kind of very clean and general and nice. In practice, it's a little bit hard to assume kind of too much structure. And intuitively, the moment we get away from this thing, we're starting to assume some kind of structure. And people could arguably criticize whether this assumption is reasonable or not. So I'll just give you one example just because it's historically important, but it's a very unrealistic source, and it will become clear why it's historically important later. So this is a source that output bits, and every bit is almost unbiased. And it's like it's, let's say, probability of zero is between 49 and 51%, and we don't assume anything else. So the bits could be correlated. Well, I mean, we do assume something. I will just write it over here. I will just say for any I and for any X, I'll give you like a stronger than normal notion. Okay, I'll give you, or for any X1, XI minus 1, probability capital XI equals 0 condition on X1 capital X I minus 1 equals little x1 little x I minus 1 is between 1 minus gamma over 2, 1 plus gamma over 2. So, and usually think of gamma like point, I don't know, 0.01, for example. So in this case, everything is really between 0.499, or I guess 0.49 or something, and you know, 0.51. Something like that. So, so this is like, and in reality, of course, you know, while for, you know, we don't expect every bit to be, you know, completely unbiased. There will be maybe some bits which are determined by the previous bits. And here we are really making an amazingly strong assumption. So, for those of you who haven't seen this before, you would think, wow, it's like, okay, this is like a toy source. It never happens. But of course, we would be able at least to tolerate that source. And we will see that even that might not be kind of possible in some cases. So the reason why this sort became important, it was so clean and nice, but it didn't make any independence assumptions. And people were like really surprised when people started to prove impossibility of doing things from this source. And we'll see some of those results coming later. And there are more examples which, right, I'll mention, well, I'll mention two more examples very quickly. It's not going to be super relevant. But rather, there is one source which is called block source. Usually, it's called KM block source. So this is a generalization of the Santavasirani source. And so here, essentially, you assume that the source X is equal X1 XN divided by M. So the source comes into blocks of length m. And the mean entropy of each block, so here I'm already going to use a notation which I didn't define. I'll define it in a second. So this is a very important notion of conditional entropy, or in this case, conditional mean entropy. But you know, for the first like 3 hours, that's the only entropy that I'm going to use. So which essentially says that mean entropy of Xi conditioned on all the previous blocks is at least k. So so roughly speaking, the, we kind of assume that at least large enough, or kind of if m is like large enough, it's reasonable to assume that at least a sufficient chunk of bits, maybe every 200 bits have, I don't know, 20 bits of entropy, even conditional, say, on the past in this case. So somehow it's not like there is like extended periods of time where there is no new entropy extended, but we don't assume that every single bit is between like 49 and 51. So here, just on the aside, I'm going to erase this thing because I don't need it. For this, I just kind of wanted to remind you what the Shannon entropy is. And so I'll write it here. So predictability of A given B equals B. Oh, actually, I guess I can define it over here. So all right. So let me define predictability of A conditioned on, or let's say, X conditioned on Y to be expected value over the choice of Y of predictability of X conditioned on Y equals on Y. So essentially, I'm saying for every particular outcome of Y, so there are these two correlated variables, X and Y, and we say that for first, we sound, you know, for every particular output of Y, we can see what's the most likely guess of X. But because, you know, there is this joint distribution of X, Y, and Y kind of comes on average, we're kind of saying overall, what is the best chance the attacker can get X when Y is chosen at random? Well, essentially, for every particular Y, the attacker will choose the most likely outcome. And on average, but you know, sometimes he could be luckier than others, depending on this little Y. So on average, this is the expected value. He will get this kind of probability of guessing X given Y. Yeah.
Why is it okay to assume that Y is an average?
Well, it's well. So first of all, here, okay. So I can justify for which applications enough. So in some applications, it's not okay. In some applications, we need to make stronger assumptions. But in majority of applications that we are going to cover, this is kind of okay because in general, when we talk about cryptography, we usually talk about average case. So for example, you're going to say, okay, assume my secret key is chosen at random. Of course, you know, if the secret key is, let's say, all zero string and the attacker hopes that the secret key is all zero string, he can break it. Of every particular secret key, he can kind of break it. But overall, usually we kind of say, okay, the secret key comes from some kind of distribution, and on average, you need to do it overall over random choice. So here, for example, yes, yeah, so this Y could be maybe the so this could be, let's say, signature of 0, and X could be signature of 1. So there is, like, overall some kind of process under which, like, the secret key is chosen. Let's say the attacker learns signature of 0, and he has to predict signature of 1. Based on signature of 0, he wants to force signature of 1. So overall, this is kind of an edge. Of course, sometimes he could be, like, really lucky for some particular signature of 0. He will know exactly signature of 1, but as long as it's on average, because this is how we define in general a game. Things kind of happen at random. You choose keys or whatever randomness at random, and you see what is the chance the attacker breaks the system or something.
Right.
Yeah. No, because, okay, good. So because here, remember, Y is, when I say it's not okay, because so we're talking about, usually in terms of applications, we're talking about different goals. So here, why we're talking about the maximum probability, because here we're thinking about X, the goal of the attacker is to guess X, or like forge a signature or something. In this case, the attacker will choose the most likely outcome. I mean, yes, it could be something in terms of probability 99%, and the other is probability half percent. He could like choose 0.5%, then he will succeed with probability 0.5%, but probably he will choose 99%. So in this case, the attacker will select the maximum thing. But here, usually when we talk about things conditioned on, so these are the kind of things that the attacker learns. So here it's like what the attacker wants to do, and this is what the attacker knows. And what the attacker knows, I mean, we usually define it average case, because for every particular worst case, I mean, sometimes we don't, but usually for kind of a cryptographic scheme, it's reasonable. So this will be like the average case kind of thing. So anyway, so this is like the definition of this block source. And here, this starts to become kind of more natural. So kind of usually, historically, this would be the best result, like one block. So this is kind of, this is like an intermediate between these two kind of cases. So this is the result, there is only one block. and you just assume an entropy of the one block. Here you assume a little bit of the structure, and here you assume that the block's only one bit, and each bit kind of has some kind of entropy. So this is kind of something in between. And I mean, I actually probably don't have time, but like I'll just mention it maybe without writing it formally. So sometimes the sources come up kind of in real life in cases which you don't really expect. So recently I was, let's say, all right, I'll spend like 2 minutes on this because it's entertaining. So recently, like some applied kind of researcher called Elaine Shi, she came to me like at NYU, and she was kind of talking about extracting randomness from Bitcoin. So because she kind of said, and some people in Princeton, they kind of suggested that you can use Bitcoin as a source of kind of public randomness. So intuitively, because there is some unpredictability about which transactions will kind of verify and the new transactions, and also they're like all there in public, and you know, assuming that this blockchain kind of converges and so on, this is like a good source of public randomness which you can predict in the past. And she kind of asked me, and some people like suggested heuristic thing, and she asked me, is it realistic? And I kind of initially, probably in practice, yes, but let's see in theory if it's realistic. So we came out with the following kind of abstraction of the source. And that was like very generous to the attacker. And somewhat surprisingly, we realized that you cannot like extract even a single random bit under this kind of pretty mild thing. So the abstraction essentially was this withholding attack. So essentially, we kind of assume that the only thing the attacker can do is, so roughly speaking, the source has this, so there is a completely random kind of thing. Let's call it Zi, is that it's completely random. It's drawn completely uniformly at random. And then this probability, essentially 1 minus gamma, similar to Santavazirani, you know, you just set Xi equals to whatever Xj is equal, well, let's say just say this, you know, some completely random solution to the puzzle is found. And if it's found by a good guy, let's say with probability 90% it will be a good guy, this solution, you know, this just becomes like the next block. The guy publishes a solution and gets the reward and so on. But with probability 10%, maybe it's like a bad miner found the solution. And if he doesn't like it, he can pretend that he didn't find it. So in this case, this probability gamma, it goes to some kind of attacker. And the attacker can, so the attacker if, and the attacker if can then decide yes or no. And if the answer is yes, he will just, you know, people will see it. And if the answer is no, people will just work on finding a new kind of solution, right? So essentially, this is kind of a very simple kind of model where, and we assume that the solution is really not controlled by the attacker. It's like perfectly uniform and so on. And it seems like this is like a very friendly source of random, because this Z could be like, you know, hundreds of thousands of bits long, maybe. So and we assume there is like, you know, at every point of time, there is like a thousand of random bits coming into you. So probability 90%, that's just, you know, output as it is completely random. And with probability 10%, the attacker cannot modify them, but he can potentially block it and hope that the next block will be good. And even for that source, turns out kind of after we used the machinery that I'm going to talk for, you know, for the next kind of 2 hours, we kind of show that even this source is not good enough for cryptography. So I'm just saying, even like as recent as now, some of these things kind of come up, some abstraction of those sources. And the way I kind of did it, I could have thought about like some really specific thing, but I tried to like really abstract at a high level and look at the first, second approximation. Already at the very first approximation, it turned out to be kind of not good enough for what we are going to do. So anyway, so for now, I will really try to concentrate on this kind of weak sources. And let's see, even though later, sometimes we'll have to make more assumptions. And now I'm going to ask the same question since we do in this kind of table is, what can we do and what cannot we do if our secret keys or whatever, in general, our randomness comes from this weak source? Right, so is the goal kind of clear? All right, so let's try just a little bit, just to get you a little bit of a kind of big picture. And you know, as I said, there are many, many other sources. And one thing I do want to say in case we don't have time to talk, well, actually, maybe it's as good time as any, I can introduce the next task over here. So the next task I'm going to say, now that we are talking about this intermediate source, this kind of weak randomness, there are two ways to go. One way is to just directly use it for a given application, soundness, authentication, privacy, and so on. And the other is to say, you know what, maybe there is a magic function called like a randomness extractor, such that we have this imperfect randomness, we just extract from this imperfect randomness perfect randomness, and now we are back to this kind of setting and we are all good, right? So this is the point of randomness extractor, so I'll put the column, and of course, in the trivial setting, this is trivial. It's the identity function, and if we have no randomness, there is no kind of extractor, all right? So now we'll try to kind of fill a little bit this kind of column. Let me get a little bit of water. Okay, so any questions so far? Okay.
When you say weak randomness, is it just the key or everything?
That's good. So for now, I'll talk about everything, but in general, it's everything, but for now, I'll just say the key. So, for various applications, it'll change, but yeah. So, for some of the impossibility, but that's actually a great question because, jumping kind of way, way ahead, we will kind of see somewhat surprisingly that. In some cases, if everything is imperfect, you cannot do, let's say, privacy. But if only the secret key is imperfect, but you have like local randomness for just randomizing stuff and so on, you can do kind of things. That's actually going to be our column number 4 at some point. To give you a little bit of an overview and what is known here. And not so with weak randomness, there are surprisingly amazing results known. So one thing which is known is that you can select, you can simulate BPP. So I'll remind people what BPP is. So the problems that can be solved in probabilistic polynomial time, we don't need very strong randomness. We can do it with extremely weak sources. So there is like a long sequence of works which shows us how to simulate the class of problems which can be actually decided in probabilistic polynomial time with weak randomness. Of course, this might not be that amazing because many people really believe that this is equal to the class P. So in this sense, the reason weak randomness is enough because you just don't need randomness altogether. But still, all those results, of course, they don't assume they're like unconditional. So this is like a big sequence of celebrated results. We had a paper a while back. I'll call it IP block is equal to IP. So in this case, we kind of said that turning to interactive protocols, what about interactive protocols? Do you need really perfect randomness? And here it's a really exciting open question. So as far as I know, not that many people think about it, whether IP weak is equal to IP. So if you have a prover and the verifier, and the verifier has access to a potentially huge random string. And the string, the only thing it has mean entropy. And the verifier is trying to catch the cheating proof from cheating. And we have some trivial results, which I'm not going to tell you the low level details. If you want, you can ask me, it's just kind of overview of a field. But essentially for the interesting setting, we don't know any kind of positive implications. And in particular, I would conjecture that the answer is no. That essentially with one block source, you probably, I'm not exactly sure, but you might go all the way to some class like MA or some kind of class, much under IP. So this is actually a great question. And if some of you like this kind of tutorial, and I'm more from the complexity theory point of view, I would love if somebody solved it. But what we did is, if we assume block source, if we essentially assume that our source of randomness comes in blocks, and there we can make like very minimal assumption. As long as essentially after like 5 rounds, no matter what I've done before, I can ensure that there is like some fresh randomness afterwards, then we can actually have some positive results over here. Okay, let me see if I want to say much more about it. Yeah, so here I guess I'll put a conjecture right here. So I guess I'll conjecture that this is impossible, even if you have like a lot of entropy. Let's say 99% of entropy, I'll conjecture that this is impossible. But of course, we'll need some complexity assumption to verify. So this is a great open question. And all right, so now let's, for the first time, talk a little bit about kind of cryptography and these kind of settings. So we are moving here. So I'm going to erase, I guess I have the SERP board, but hopefully people just remember what the definition of mean entropy is. And maybe I'll erase this and I'll just write. So I'll just remind people that kvic means the only thing you assume that h infinity of x is greater or equal k. So let's start with the question of authentication. And here I'll just start. I mean, we can do something more general. But yeah, there was like a really nice paper of Maurer and Wolf in 97 that essentially it shows that you can do one-time message authentication codes. So I'm using abbreviations, I mean, but I will define everything that I need to define. This is just a little bit for the overview. So we can do one-time max provided that k is at least n over 2. So you can do some non-trivial message authentication, like one-time message authentication code provided that the mean entropy of the secret key for the message authentication code is at least n over 2. So alternatively, sometimes we use the word trait. So entropy rate of our source is at least a half. So this half looks kind of a little bit strange and maybe somewhat surprising. But it turns out, I mean, we observed it in the paper with Spencer and also later generalized it with Vix, addressing your questions about local randomness, that actually k greater than n over 2 is, so k less than n over 2 is indeed impossible. Okay, so let me give you a very brief kind of flavor of the impossibility results. Actually, the intuition is very simple, at least if you don't have like local randomness, but it turns out even with like local randomness for message authentication, this doesn't really help. So let me give you the intuition. So already we see some kind of interesting set of positive and negative results that for the question of one-time message authentication code, there is this threshold. So I will not define one-time max, but I will just more or less try to just specialize it. So let's assume the domain is 0, 1. And we'll assume information theoretic security. So in this case, roughly speaking, the way I can define it is, I can actually already define it with this notation. So if our secret key is x, and the attacker tries to predict tag of s, of 0 given tag of S of 1, or alternatively, if the attacker tries to predict tag of 1 given, so I will say security, security delta is equal to 2 to the minus t if both of these quantities are at least t. So now you see we can handily use our conditional mean entropy. So roughly speaking, it just says that the attacker for this particular case in general, we can talk about some attacker adaptively choosing messages and some other stuff, but let's just ignore it for now. So in this case, the definition is really simple. If I give the attacker for a randomly chosen key S, so the key S is sampled from X and X belongs you know, from our source. So actually, I guess I should use X, notation X. Yeah, let's use notation X instead of S. So yeah, in this case, we just, you know, so in this case, what's a message authentication code? You know, the secret key on one bit, the secret key is just comes from the source, and you can either output the tag of 0 or tag of 1, and if the attacker sees one, he cannot predict the other, right? So notice just kind of as a warm-up, if X is truly uniform, what is a very simple one bit, you know, message authentication code for one bit? Can somebody suggest, you know, it turns out to be actually optimal, but can somebody suggest a very good way to authenticate one bit message? If I have a secret key, let's say 100 bit secret key, which is truly random, what can I do? So what should I do if I want to authenticate 0? What is the tag of 0? Right, so I have 100 bits that are perfectly random for now. I'm just kind of, just to make sure. The first 50 bits will be tag of 0. The second 50 bits are tag of 1. It turns out this is actually optimal. You'll achieve security 2 to the minus 50. Tag of 0 and tag of 1 are completely unrelated. So therefore, you know, and because each of them are 50 bits long, you cannot do much. And notice that this kind of starts to a little bit explain where this n over 2 is here. So if the mean entropy of the key is only 50 bits and the key is 100 bits, if you look at this very particular tag, of course, what would be a very bad situation where this scheme will not be secure, right? So remember our scheme, so this is like a side, just to get, so a side, assume x is equal x0, x1, and tag x of b is x sub b. And assume h infinity of x is equal to n over 2, right?
What is n?
Oh, n in all of the notations, I forgot, I should have defined it. N is, in this case, always the length of the secret key. I guess I define it over here. When I talk about distributions, I'll just assume that our randomness comes from, I just gave it a letter 0, 1 to the n. And in this case, for now, you know, answering John Paul's question is, we'll just assume that all the randomness is used for the secret key because we look at very simple kind of schemes. So this is like a very simple message authentication scheme. So why, if the mean entropy of X is only known to be n over 2, I claim that the scheme is not secure, right? What would be a very simple attack? So in this case, let me just clarify, what does the attack mean, just so that we have the rule of the game. So the reason I differentiate between source and distributions because I kind of assume that if I tolerate a source, it means I want to find one scheme that works for any distribution on the source. And if you want to attack my scheme, you're free to choose your favorite distribution as long as it is in the source. So can somebody specify a very simple distribution on x0 and x1 which will have mean entropy n over 2? You cannot predict this probability more than 2 to the n over 2, but where this message authentication code is insecure. Right, so for example, you can set x to be, so this notation like 0, n over 2, concatenate it. So this notation u sub, you know, some number, it means uniform distribution on this many bits. That's another notation. So in this case, if x is this distribution, you can just completely tag of x of 0 is just equal to 0 to the n over 2. Right, so this will be completely insecure, right? Just to get you, I know it's a very simple example, but just to get you some kind of intuition of the games that we are playing. Right, so the games that we are playing, at least for now, we would like to tolerate this weak source. So this is the only thing we know about the source is the mean entropy of the source, and we would like to design a message authentication code for just one bit. So this is a definition. I don't, you know, you see very simple definition, no complicated things. And we kind of saw that at least the naive scheme doesn't work, but maybe there is another scheme that works. So here is a cute proof that no scheme works. I guess I cannot raise this thing up. So all right, I'll draw it there, and then maybe we'll use that board for something else. So so here is a very simple proof. So imagine, so this L is all tags of 0. And R are all tags of 1, right? And imagine that for any particular secret key X, I will draw an edge from tag sub x of 0 to tag tag sub x of 1. So roughly speaking, I draw the graph. I don't know what the domain is, but you know, what I know is there are 2 to the n edges here. All right? So for every particular secret key, it will correspond to an edge connecting tag of 0 to tag of 1. And we assume this is deterministic, but as I said in the follow-up work, we extended it to probabilistic ones, just to give you the idea of how a general impossibility, maybe I'll move it a little bit over here, how general impossibility result would work. Okay, so what is the game? We have to come up with a, you know, so let's call this capital N. So mean entropy, N over 2, intuitively means that I have to come up with a distribution on edges such that you cannot guess my edge with probability better than 1 over square root of N, right? So, h infinity of x equal n over 2, or greater or equal n over 2, it means that predictability of x is less than 1 over square root of capital N. All right. So, we want to argue that for any graph like that, I can come up on distribution on edges such that either if I give you tag of 0, it's easy to get tag of 1, in case it will be easy with probability 1, or the other way around. Okay? So here is what we are going to do. We will just kind of say, listen, there are two cases. So let's look at case 1. Case 1 is there exists alpha belonging to the left side such that degree of alpha is, such a degree of alpha, I guess it's less than square root of n. All right, so let's see. So, there exists things such that this is greater. So I assume there exists a node, let's call it alpha, such that there are more than square root of n edges coming up here. So I claim in this case I'm pretty good to go. What should I do in this case to forge a tag of 0? So these are tags of 0. So I claim if there exists a node such as there are more than square root of n edges coming out of here, I can come up with very simple distribution such that it's very easy to predict tag of 0. What would be the distribution? Uniform distribution of the edges. So again, just to, so that we kind of understand the kind of things. I mean, usually we'll, there will be more impossibility results coming up. But in this case, you know, as I said, so to argue that you cannot have any one-time mag when the security is less, when the mean entropy is less than little n over 2, all I need to do is like for any scheme, and I conveniently present the scheme as a graph, for any scheme like that, I have to come up with a distribution. I look at this graph and I come up with a distribution where it's easy to forge a mag. And I'm looking at the case. I said, listen, if there exists a guy on the left with very high degree, it's very easy. I'll take uniform distribution here. So let's make x to be uniform here. And if x is uniform distribution here, what do I know about tag of 0? It's equal to alpha, right? So, and in this case, even without seeing tag of 1, tag x of 0 is equal to alpha, so I forge a mag with probability 1, right? Well, what if we are not lucky? Maybe the attacker is not going to be stupid enough, or not the attacker, in this case, it's a good guy, the designer of the scheme, right? Maybe he will come up with a graph where all the nodes on the left have low degree, right? So this is the second case. So in this case, here is what we are going to do. So if the nodes, all nodes have low degree, I will do the following thing. I claim that in this case, I can find a matching of size at least square root of n. So if all the nodes have low degree, so here's what I do. I take like the very first node. It has less than square root of n edges. So I'll just choose an arbitrary edge, okay? And I delete all the other edges. So I picked one edge and deleted square root of n edges. But there are n total edges. So I will take another node. And again, I'll choose one arbitrary edge and delete everything else. So roughly speaking, the procedure will be take a node, pick arbitrary edge, and delete the rest. So and so on. Pick a node, take one edge, and delete the rest, and so on. So how many times can I do this procedure? So I have n total edges. And every time I do it, I delete at most square root of n edges, square root of n minus 1, but right? So how many times can I do it? So there are n total edges. And every time I do it, I delete square root of n. So it means I can do it at least square root of n times, right? So what does it mean? It means that I have square root of n distinct guys over here, right? It's not necessarily a matching, yeah. It's not necessarily a matching. It's like, it's good enough for me, right? So in this case, what is going to be my distribution? It's going to be uniform on this at least square root of n edges. Again, it has mean entropy at least n over 2 because predictability is 1 over square root of n. But now, what do I do in this case? I claim that I will ask what is tag of 0. I will get one of these nodes. But each of these nodes has a unique guy remaining, right, because I killed all the other guys coming of this node. So once I know tag of 0, I know for sure tag of 1. I get this guy, I know it's here. I get this guy, I know it's here, and so on, right? So once again, so in this case, given tag sub x of 0, know tag sub x of 1. Yeah? So this is case 2. Sorry, so I didn't try. So case 1 was there was one guy with a lot of nodes, then I took uniform distribution here. If this is the case, I'm done. Otherwise, all the guys have low degree, and I find this matching or close enough to matching, and I give another distribution. So it's just one of the cases has to happen, and depending on the case, I will give you a different distribution on contradicting security on MAC. In one case, the distribution allows me for sure predict tag of 0. In the other case, given tag of 0, it for sure predicts tag of 1. So this is kind of a cute little proof. It kind of shows that this n over 2 is not like a random number. There is some kind of reason for it, but it came from this kind of thing. So what about positive results? So this is actually, let's start to do something kind of positive, because there will be a lot of more negative results coming. For positive result, I don't want to say much. I just kind of, for those of you who haven't seen, I'll. I guess hopefully there will be enough board space, but all right, I don't need this. So here there will be actually something that will be super useful. It's the original paper of this Maurer and Wall, what we did, they kind of took like a standard message syndication code and had a direct proof that this code also works as long as the mean entropy is at least 10 over 2 and get some bound. And what we observed later in we pushed it quite far. We made a really general observation, which really says that for application-like authentication, you can actually very often translate security with uniform key to a weaker but still not trivial security with weak keys, right? So this is kind of a very general lemma that I kind of want to mention. And so the lemma is the following. So for any x such that h infinity of x is greater than n minus d, well, this is equal to k. It's just more convenient for me to talk about the entropy deficiency in this case as opposed to the mean entropy. And for any function f to non-negative numbers, so for any real valued function which is non-negative, I claim that the expected value of f of x is at most 2 to the d times the expected value of f of uniform distribution. So essentially, the question I'm asking is, listen, I have some non-negative function f, and I want to look at its expected value with respect to uniform distribution. That's a good case scenario. It's like if I have like a uniform kind of secret key or something like that. And on the other hand, maybe I don't have a uniform key. I have one of those weak keys which have d bits of entropy deficiency. Yeah, I want to see how far does the expected value you know, how much worse could it become? And the, you know, not so surprising, but like very easy answer, it can increase by at most a factor of 2 to the d. So let me see the proof of this result. So the proof is really very simple. Expected value of f of x is sum of a little x of f of x times probability x is equal to x. And because the function is non-negative, I can just, you know, each of those probabilities at most, you know, upper bounded by predictability. So this is at most predictability of x times sum of f of x, OK? And just to be difficult, I'll multiply and divide both parts by 2 to the n. So here I'll just write f of x times 1 over 2 to the n, right? So, and what is predictability of x? So this is at most, so this term is at most 2 to the d. Why? Well, because the mean entropy is n minus d, it means that no element has a probability more than 2 to the d divided by 2 to the n. So I multiply by 2 to the n, it cancels. And what about this term? What is this? Well, let's just match it up. So I have 2 to the d, so it must be the expected value of f of x under uniform distribution. Why? Well, because that's what uniform distribution is, an indefinite. It's like every element happens probability 2 to the minus n. So this is 2 to the d times 2 to the d times expected value of f of x. All right, so that's a cute one-line kind of thing. But f of u, sorry, yeah. Well, it's, what I wrote is also true, but yeah, so f of un, yes. So all right, so this was like a really simple proof. But surprisingly, I mean, it has powerful implications, and not just to this thing, but to many other cases. So in particular, let's apply it to authentication applications. So maybe I'll continuously use that board and so if I want to apply it to authentication applications, what do I do? All right, let's just think, you know, abstractly. What is an authentication application? So it means I sample a secret key from, you know, so I play some kind of game. I sample a secret key from my distribution. And then the attacker, he can, like, find out something. And at the end, he has to forge something. He has to, like, compute, you know, predict tag of 0, or forge a signature, or something like that. So in this case, he will have to, you know, forge a message. Not necessarily 0-1 here. We are talking about general message authentication codes. So roughly speaking, and you know, what is it measured, you know, how do we measure his success probability? Well, we just literally compute the success probability of the attacker, right? So roughly speaking, we can let f of x to be probability A forges or whatever succeeds in outputting something. It's probability A forges succeeds on secret key equals x. Right, so I can just define this function f of x to be the probability the attacker succeeds. Right, this is my function f of x. And because it's a probability, it is indeed non-negative. Right, so the conditions of this lemma are satisfied. Right? So what does it mean? It means that whenever, whatever is the probability, so this is what we want to upper bound. We want to say the attacker, even though the key comes from a weak source, the attacker will not succeed with high probability. And what we argued, we said this probability is at most 2 to the entropy deficiency times probability the attacker succeeds on uniform distribution, right? But what do we know about the attacker succeeding on uniform distribution? Well, we know we compress the whole theory of message authentication codes to a check mark. We know that he cannot do it, right? We'll use something good for which the attacker cannot actually succeed very well. So we will know that the attacker cannot actually succeed via either proof or assumes that he cannot succeed in uniform distribution. Therefore, we have like a particular, you know, kind of penalty, which is this 2 to the d. So what is the corollary? So what corollary is, if, how do you want to call application, if P is, let's just call delta secure authenticate. So here, you know, authentication application about some class of attackers. Authentication application in ideal model, in an ideal randomness model, then P is 2 to the n minus k times delta secure in k weak model. So essentially, whatever is the security we have with respect to uniform distribution, again, is whatever class of attackers. So here, maybe we can talk about computationally unbounded attackers. But then if you talk about signature scheme, we don't really care about. We're saying whatever, you know, unfortunately, I erased this derivation. But this derivation was just like, you know, computation of expected value. It didn't care about computational efficiency or anything like that. It just says whatever class of attackers we have security in the ideal model, we have at most 2 to the n minus k some delta security in the kind of real model, right? Well, of course, that looks actually pretty bad, this 2 to the n minus k. And indeed, in some cases, it could be too bad. It depends on this thing. But for mass authentication code, it's not too bad. So for max, I mean, I don't want to spend too much time, but just to give you an idea if, in case you haven't seen it. For max, so here is a classical one-time Mac. So classical one-time Mac is essentially X, you write it as A concatenation B. Both of them are n over 2 bits long. So AB is 0, 1 to the n over 2. And here, for this, for convenience, we'll view it as a finite field of size 2 to the n over 2. We'll just identify this domain with this finite field. And we'll also assume that the message also belongs to this Galois field of size 2 to the n over 2. And the classical tag AB of M is simply AM plus B. So this is like one of those classical things that you learn in one of the first cryptography classes, how to do a one-time mass authentication. So this function is pairwise independent. So more generally, you can apply any pairwise in what we call, if you haven't seen it, don't worry about it. So this is intuition. So intuition, and of course, you can make a formal proof. It's not very hard. Intuition is, for any value of alpha, which would be tag of AB of M, so for any alpha and for any alpha prime and for any M not equal NM prime, there exists unique AB such that alpha is equal AM plus B, and alpha prime is equal AM prime plus B. Right, so this is like, this is what pairwise independence means. It just means, in particular, it just means, even if I tell you alpha, you don't know anything about alpha prime. Because for any possible alpha prime, there exists a unique explanation of AB, so intuitively, you just didn't learn anything. Or more specifically, it just means, you know, speaking in more kind of language, it means that for any M and prime, essentially, tag of X of M prime is uniform, is actually equivalent, so three equal signs. It's a uniform N over 2-bit strings conditioned on tag of X of M. So anyway, if you haven't seen it, this is just kind of two. So this is like a classical one-time Mac. And the question is, what security does it achieve? So in the security it achieves, it's essentially a generalization of this splitting the thing into two. It essentially says that if I tell you tag of X of M, for any other different mass M prime, it's just a uniform string element of the field. So you cannot predict this probability more than 2 to the minus n over 2. Right? So if you haven't seen it, great. If you haven't seen it, it's just the only thing you need to know is that it's a very simple construction with a like one-line proof, which achieves security 2 to the minus n over 2. So let's just apply it here, right? So if we apply it here, we get that the new security delta prime is 2 to the minus n over 2 times 2 to the n minus k. And if we simplify it, it becomes what? 2 to the n over 2 minus k. Okay? Are you guys with me? So I just plugged it in. So what does it mean? Remember, what did I try to tell you? I tried to tell you that as long as k is greater than n over 2, we have some non-trivial security. And indeed, this is what we got over here. As long as k is a little bit more than n over 2, you start to get a little bit of security, right, in this case. And the way we achieved it, I mean, unlike like Maurer and Wolf, I mean, who kind of had a specific proof, which was short, it wasn't like a big deal, but it's really part of this general kind of methodology that for authentication applications, you generically get essentially at least some kind of security with weak keys, at least when the entropy deficiency is small. So it just kind of said that security cannot suddenly disappear if you go from uniform keys to slightly non-uniform keys. It like decreases fast, exponentially, but it doesn't go in one shot. And we will contrast it with like things like privacy momentarily, where we will see that there kind of the moment you can lose one bit, you know, of security in the key, or of entropy in the key, the security can completely disappear. So at least for authentication application, this is not the case. So let me try to write something in this column just to fill it in. So authentication, so something is possible, at least I'm talking about one way, if k, if and only if k is greater or equal n over 2, at least for one time max. I'll write OTM to stand for one time max. So at least some, you know, something is possible, non-trivial. Something very good, unfortunately, is impossible. And actually, there is not that much work for other things. We did have one of the earlier papers which kind of showed, you know, and we can also do like signatures for any k, well, for any k using some exponential assumptions. Here I don't want to spend too much time on it. I want to move a little bit on privacy. But just to give you some overview of authentication, the common wisdom is, yeah, for information theoretic setting, we can kind of characterize what is possible. At least like for one time max, it's like the tight bound is n over 2. We can talk about like multi-time max, you know. And essentially, the more demanding is the max, at least information theoretically, the more demanding the requirement on mean entropy is. But under computational assumptions, if we start to believe that, for example, there are like exponentially hard one-way functions and so on, there are some words which, you know, given it's my work, I can say I wouldn't call them super elegant. But, you know, under appropriately strong assumptions, you can do stuff. So essentially, the common belief is for authentication applications, it's kind of, if you assume something strong enough, it is OK. You can actually do them with weak randomness. So you can achieve this desirable goal with this. And one way to kind of do it in practice, for those of you who know about cryptographic hash functions, you'll just take your key, you just plug it into SHA-3. Before it was SHA-2, now it's, let's say, SHA-3 or something like that. You just plug it, you plug it there. And intuitively, for all practical reasons, it will be kind of good enough. As long as the key was unpredictable beforehand, people, you know, there will be not enough weaknesses in SHA. Some code will be scrambled enough. So by and large, I'll write it on top. So by and large, there is some kind of check marks with caveats. So yeah. So we have, there are only two papers where we considered them. And the reason there are not more, it's like, it seems, yeah, it's like given some of those impossibilities, it's clear that you need to start making assumptions. And right now, the only kind of assumptions under which we can do something is some kind of, yeah, like exponentially secure in one-way permutations. And there is more caveats. We cannot actually do it for weak, so, you know, for just a source. We also do it for only block source. And it's kind of ugly. So, yeah, feel free to look into it and maybe clean it up or something. So, yeah, like for example, one time X, it should be entirely doable. I don't know if many people looked into it. But yeah, it should be entirely doable to do k k less than n over 2 under hopefully like semi-reasonable kind of assumption, some kind of exponential hardness or something like that. People haven't done it because I guess there was more fun in this corner. So is the bound, well, so that's, we cannot say the bound. It's like, you know, you say if something is, it depends on the exponential security we assume from like our one-way permutation. And to be honest, it's kind of tough because I want to get it, but you know, we don't have that many candidates for one-way permutations. There's some kind of discrete log, and so it's much less elegant than what I'm going to talk about next. So maybe, oh, here, question. No, I mean, if k equals n over 2, this impossibility result that I guess erased by now, it's, yeah, yeah, so it's, I guess, yeah, it's, well, yeah. Yeah, no, so technically, yeah, so you need, and that's actually tight, even that, you need this, yeah. I'm just kind of giving you qualitative kind of things, and, okay, so for privacy, so maybe we'll start privacy after the break. I just want to kind of set it up a little bit. Just to give you some kind of examples. So one thing which is kind of bad here, you know, if you look at this kind of degradation, so yeah, just because we move for privacy, let's, I guess, I can start erasing these things. So let's look at one-time pad, right? So that's like a conventional, very nice privacy application. So we are moving to privacy. And let's start with one-time pad. So what is the one-time pad encryption? Is encryption of x of m is x plus m. I mean, it could be one bit and could be multiple bits. But yeah, let's say for here it's n bits. So x and m are m bits, n bits long. OK. So now this scheme is perfectly secure. If x is drawn from uniform distribution, the scheme is perfectly secure. Because intuitively, for any m0 not equal, of just for any message m, essentially m plus uniform distribution is equal, in the distributional sense, it's still a uniform distribution. Right? So if you take a message and you shift it by a random amount, you just get a random amount. So obviously, you get no information about the message. So now, kind of as a simple kind of warm-up question, what if the only thing you know that the mean entropy of x is n minus 1? Is one-time pad a secure scheme? Right, so we have a classical, like, you know, secure scheme with uniform randomness. I want to see maybe it's kind of trivially. So maybe this degradation that I just erased still kind of works here. And okay, so any takers, it should be pretty simple. Oh, sorry, no. Okay, so yeah, so essentially, listen, set x to be uniform n minus 1 concatenation with 0, right? So that's a distribution of mean entropy n minus 1. So very high mean entropy. But now, if you do encryption of m1 mn. So what is this? It's going to be some noise. But what is the last bit concatenated with mn? Right? Because this is essentially, OK, let's just write it explicitly. It's m1 mn minus 1, 0 plus, key concatenation 0, so this is like something concatenated with n sub n. So essentially, I'm just giving you the last bit of the message in the clear, right? So this is, I mean, of course, you can say, oh, it's like artificial. But remember, this is a game we play. If you say it's artificial, of course, then we'll have to make some more assumptions beyond mean entropy. And ideally, we would like to just kind of base everything only on mean entropy. But you know, of course, here you can say, what about like Santa-Vazirani? Well, even if Santa-Vazirani, just if the last bit is a little bit biased, I'll make it 51% biased. Now you can guess a bit of the message probability 51%. And for privacy application, this is actually bad. Like even 1% break of privacy is considered bad. We want like negligible breaks of privacy. So here we have this kind of very sharp kind of drop that like for authentication, we have a relatively smooth thing. You know, if we start with good enough security, it kind of degrades very slowly. And it's slow enough to get semi-interesting, well, actually not semi, but you know, somewhat interesting results with weak randomness. And yeah, if you know, I'll point you to the paper, we have like more, you know, somewhat more, you know, more surprising even implication of this trivial one-line lemma. And it's, you know, that, you know, you don't have to even worry about application, just translate from uniform to uniform. And here is just you lose one bit of entropy, and somehow at least this particular scheme kind of completely drops. And of course, the question is it just maybe we can do a smarter one-time pad? Maybe we can like fix the one-time pad scheme and somehow make it secure. Or maybe even more ambitiously, maybe we can design a randomness extractor for the weak source over here and get some kind of results. And unfortunately, what we are going to spend, I'll give you a little bit of a kind of two-minute preview, and then I guess we'll take the break for the second kind of part, where we'll start getting a lot of those kind of impossibility results. Essentially, it will turn out that the answer, I'll maybe pre-fill the table, but the answer will be largely, and in a very strong sense, it will be a largely, all right, let's not waste time on largely, there will be a pretty big X over here, and this X will come up with like pretty multiple sense, it will be pretty strong. Not only we would be not be able to tolerate like weak sources, even like things like Santa Vazirani sources, so a lot of like very restricted sources, already privacy somehow appears to be more demanding, and in fact, we will have one of my favorite kind of results of mine in this area, that essentially the only way to more or less achieve good privacy, to building a good enough encryption from a source doesn't necessarily have to be a weak source, is necessarily through randomness extraction. So essentially, if you can do something at all, then you can do it through just essentially extracting a uniform thing and then using one-time pad. And there is even a funny story about it, I'll conclude before going to the break. So we had like two papers on the subject. So the first paper that I wrote in 2002 with Joel Spencer, the title of the paper was on the non-universality of the one-time pad. We kind of asked this question. We said, there is hope that we don't need to go through randomness extraction. I gave something like pretty artificial, and I'll tell you exactly what it was after the break. But essentially, we built some artificial source where you can do one bit encryption. You can do some kind of, perfectly encrypt one bit, but you cannot extract one bit. So at least, there was a source where you can encrypt one bit, but not extract one bit. And then we called it on the non-universality of one-time pad. Very geeky title, but the point is like there is hope in the world. Maybe we can build cryptography on non-extractable sources. And then we wrote a follow-up paper, which I had a temptation to call it on the universality of the one-time pad, but then it would be making fun of me, so I decided not to do it. And it was called something like, does privacy require true randomness? And unfortunately, we kind of showed that modulo a very small slack. Essentially, if you have a source of randomness good for encryption, it must be kind of extractable. So there would be a pretty big kind of X, and we're actually going to see all those proofs. And they're actually surprisingly simple. They were not maybe simple when we just came up with it, but in the upcoming years when I taught this stuff and simplified this stuff, we came up with a lot of simplifications. So now all those things pretty elementary, so hopefully you will see those kind of proofs. But what I'm going to start the second third of this kind of tutorial is with a general framework. To show impossibility of privacy under some kind of source L. And this is a culmination of several works of ours. But really, the latest one was just from Crypto last year. In 2015, I had a paper with a visiting student, Yang-Quin Yao, where it kind of cleaned up those previous papers and really gave something like very simple in general, and hopefully you will appreciate it, which kind of also explains to you why privacy is so much more demanding on randomness. So just to give you, the plan for the next hour and a half. So we will largely be kind of concentrating in these two lines, and then transition to the last column for the third one. For the third part of this tutorial. And I'll take questions before the break. So also let me know, I mean, feel free to come to me in the break or something, but we'll see, maybe I'll write a slide over there to save the board. But if I'm a little bit too slow, I'm totally happy to speed up. I just wasn't sure. And it seems like a good kind of transition to get people warmed up about the topic, but I can definitely go faster if people ask me to. Oh, sorry. Well, that wasn't the goal of trying to avoid through extractors, but yeah, in some sense, well, you can say the goal is through going through extractors because, if extractors were possible and it was like very cheap, of course, we can always just go through extractors. But from a philosophical kind of perspective, it would be nice if we can actually, if encryption didn't require extraction. So from this perspective, you can say, yes, I'm trying to kind of avoid extractors. So in this sense, it could be one goal, but of course, our goal was to figure out whatever the truth is. But what is going to be very interesting, if we compare the second cert with the last cert of the talk, so when we don't have any kind of local randomness where everything is just kind of in the secret key, roughly speaking, we will see that kind of privacy really requires extraction. There is kind of no difference. When we move to the last column, as we will see, extraction, I'm just stealing my own thunder, extraction kind of becomes possible. And there again, the common wisdom was that essentially to deal with something, you can just like extract from a bad key, extract a good key, and then do conventional crypto. And there, surprisingly, we showed that this is not the case. We can actually do much better in very practical applied sense. We can actually, in this setting, we can actually derive better keys which are not uniform, but yet are very good keys for like privacy and authentication. So that will be like in the third, just to give you the preview of what we are going to do. Yeah.
Maybe a philosophical question. Why care about information theoretic security if at the end of the day you're going to do computational security?
Right. So that's a very good question. So a couple of answers, I guess. Of course, it's not like I really want, I happen to like information theoretic security, it's like elegant and so on, but of course, it's like the strongest kind of thing. If you get a positive result, it means it applies to anything, so we don't have to worry about, and if the result is like very strong, why settle for computational assumption if somebody like breaks factoring and so on, et cetera. So yeah, if you have a positive result, of course, it's great. For a negative result, I agree. You can view that if information theoretic kind of stuff is impossible, go for computational. But here I want to stress that I'm not talking about, here the goal, the power of the attacker is to mess with the source, your source of randomness. And the schemes, all our results, they apply equally to information theoretic or computational schemes. Well, not our results, but majority of our results. So here really, it's not about information theoretic security. It's just a question is, what assumption about the source do we need to make so that we can tolerate the source? And here you could validly criticize some of the results, not the ones that I'm going to talk about in this thing, but some of the earlier results that we improved, that there the attackers, they broke the security of things, but like the thing with the graph, if the graph is exponential size, maybe it's hard for me to find a node with high degree or to compute this matching. I mean, those could be hard problems or to come up with this distribution. Maybe it's not efficiently samplable. And so that's a valid criticism, and that's why in some of the follow-up results, most of the impossibility results, usually with a little bit of effort, sometimes no trivial effort, they extend even to efficiently samplable kind of attackers if you restrict the distribution to be efficiently samplable. Sometimes it's very technical. I might mention it if people are interested. So I'm not going to care about efficient sampleability, but in terms of computational versus information theoretic security, these results, they don't really care about it. So in some sense, positive results work for everything. Negative results could be extended to at least efficiently sampled distribution. But in terms of applications, whether it's signature or MAC, they apply for everything. The only exception where, I mean, I assume Leo will talk about it much more, computational security, we could derive better parameters for using computational extractors where the output is not going to be perfectly or statistically close to random, but it's going to be pseudo-random. But even there, surprisingly, I assume Hugi will talk about it, essentially the difference only starts to make sense after the initial level. It's like, you know, I don't know, you have to be, I guess, over 18 to drive, and then maybe the older you become, you start to drive like really better or something like that, if I don't know, whatever it is. But somehow, the minimal amount of entropy from which we can extract, there is still a little bit of gap between information theoretic and computational security. There is a great question that maybe Leo is going to talk about tomorrow, about like whether computational extractors have better what we call startup min entropy. What is the minimal amount of entropy I need to start doing cryptography? But in terms of the startup amount, the differences like appears to be very small. It's just, you know, getting more and more. That's why like these pseudorandom generators and so on bio stuff. But so far there seem to be very little gain in computational security in this kind of area. And hopefully it will become clear. But this is a great question, so I definitely very much encourage you guys asking me philosophical questions, because I hope this is, you know, at least for the first day, this is like the right setting for this, and I'll try to do my best to answer those. All right, so we'll resume.